the Deets. In association with What's Good Calgary, starring your host, Duddy Does It. Featuring actor Joe Perry.
Do you do vocal exercises?
To warm up for theater?
Yeah.
Sometimes. Sometimes it's just sort of random meandering, like, yeah, sure, why not? And I'll just take lines from the show, but there is vocal warm-ups that I'll do, depending on the show, really.
As I've been editing, I'm like, I'm so monotone, and I'm trying to fix it. So now when I'm talking to people all day, I'm trying to use different tones and
like just inflections in your voice.
Yeah.
How do you like intentionally? So when you're speaking to someone, you're like just trying to like modulate your voice.
It makes me sick because it seems so fake. I'm just like, hey, hey, how's it going? At work too. Welcome. Oh, it sounds like a robot. It's just, I don't like it. I'm monotone. I am what I am.
I think it's like, especially, I don't notice any monotone when I was watching the clips that you're doing, but it is funny. Like I've been doing a lot of different accents in the last few shows that I've been doing. And that's the first thing that they talk about is like the tone, the tonality and the musicality of the different places. And like Alberta prairie stuff is very,
People always think I'm being sarcastic or something. Like when they say something and I'm like, oh, that's very interesting. Or like, oh yeah, cool. That's cool.
And you're like, genuine, but it just sounds like you're fucking with them.
Oh, sorry. Like I didn't, never mind. Anyway, we're rolling.
Oh, good.
I don't know which camera. So thanks for coming down. My guest is Joe Perry. An actor. Maybe you want to tell us a little bit more about yourself. Give a bio, I guess.
Yeah, for sure. So I'm an actor. I'm based out of Calgary, Alberta, but I've worked across Canada over the past decade or so. I trained at the U of A. I trained at Mount Royal University. They had a program that was cut, unfortunately, quite a few years ago, but it was a great acting training program. So I did theater training there. And then at the University of Alberta in their BFA in acting. And then I've worked in film, TV, and theater kind of across Canada over the last decade or so, just over longer.
It's food.
It's all fucking frozen.
All those MREs have flameless heaters. Just look for the gray or green packets. All right, listen up. Here's what we're gonna do. We work together and rig out this netting, pull this whole thing out of this valley, get over that ridge. Then we can keep our fair share of all of it. Or you could stuff your pockets, eat for a couple days, maybe. It's up to you.
It's a good plan.
How about you put that thing away first?
That's fucking funny. Name's Sam.
I remember we met a long time ago, probably 10 or 15 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And at the time, I think you were doing Shakespeare at the Park or something.
Yeah, I would have just been graduating from Mount Royal College, but they were just turning into Mount Royal University.
Yeah.
And then I would have been doing Shakespeare in the Park before it became Shakespeare by the Bow. So this was when it was before it was being run by Theatre Calgary,
okay,
which it is now. And
So it takes a long time to get going, hey?
Well, I think with any sort of like career trajectory, it takes there's training and then there's just gaining a resume and just doing work and getting your feet under you. And in acting, for sure, there's so many different kind of streams you can go through theater, film. I mean, those are the two main ones, but even within that, there's independent theater, there's commercial theater, there's musical theater, there's all sorts of
stuff.
Is
there still a lot of people going into acting?
I wouldn't have any like facts on that, but like I feel like there's still like all of the programs are full, but they're all kind of smaller classes.
Mm-hmm.
So like if you look at a theater training program, like the one that I went to, they intake 12 folks a year.
Okay.
And that's always full, but at this in the scale of Canadian theater, that's not a ton of folks, like 12 people. But across the programs across Canada, I think there is still quite a lot of folks going into it. I think that the idea of what an actor is has kind of changed over the last decade, especially with like content creation, TikTok, YouTube, all that. So it's not just film and TV, and the folks that you see on TV aren't all just trained actors. They could be coming from content creation.
Yeah,
could
it might be
from all different sides.
Easier for some people to go that route to gain some traction online and then get into it.
Yeah, I think. I don't know what comes first. Whether you're like creating content and then you try and move into some more like character-based acting, or if it goes the other way around. I have some friends who have gone from acting into content creation as well. So it goes, I think it goes both ways.
Are there people that just, like it happens in the States, people just go to Hollywood or LA and try to make it? Does that happen with people in like here going to Vancouver and Toronto?
I mean, like in a sense, I would say, yeah. Like I lived in Toronto for a while, but I think the idea, in my opinion, the idea of going and trying to make it is kind of a fallacy no matter what. Like when you see somebody who's kind of come up out of the blue, it's very rare that they've just sort of moved to a place, got an agent and just like got their break, right? So anytime you see somebody who's new to you, they've probably been doing it for a decade, they've probably been doing their local theater, they've probably been doing independent films. But if you do want to get some traction, it does help to go to a bigger center sometimes.
Mm-hmm. What's it like as an actor in Calgary? And also, I think Alberta's trying to expand a lot, right? So have you been noticing it a lot too?
I think the community in Calgary and in Alberta, whether it's theater or film acting, is it's unbelievable. It's awesome. And it is just growing. It's always been a community that I've loved. And now that there's more stuff shooting here, there's more audiences in theaters after the pandemic and over the past year, I think that there's more and more opportunity. I think that the community and being an actor in Calgary and based out of Alberta it's a great place to be right now.
A lot of good plays I've been to recently. I saw you a couple times.
Mm-hmm.
Extractionist.
Mm-hmm.
I saw you. And then Jekyll and Hyde, which was crazy to me. That was great acting, by the way.
Thank you. Yeah, that was a lot of fun.
Yeah. Some of the best I've seen. I've gone there for 10 years or more, probably. It was really good.
Thank you.
And then The Christmas Carol, which you've done before, right?
Yeah, I've done a different version of Carol. Those three, I love that you brought up those three. So speaking of like local arts, The Extractionist is written by a local Alberta playwright, Michaela Jeffries, and that was a premiere. Like that was a world premiere of that play,
mm-hmm.
which I think we take for granted sometimes that we have that caliber of like playwrights and production in our city. Like it's world class in my opinion.
Yeah, you could just, if you told me it was a traveling it was amazing.
Yeah,
they've all been really great lately.
Yeah, I think the quality is just, I mean, it's second to none. I went back to that, but I forgot the question.
Jekyll and Hyde and The Christmas Carol, you were saying. It's funny I brought those, or it's nice that I brought those three up.
Well, it's just, and then speaking of local talent, like the adaptation of Christmas Carol is always done by somebody who's around, and the one that you saw this year was done by another local Alberta playwright called Jeffrey Simon Brown. But yeah, I have done that before. I did the Carol back in 2015 and 2016, which was adapted by Dennis Garnham, and then they commissioned Jeffrey to do this version of Carol back in 2019. I don't know all of the details behind all of that, so it's just my experience with it, but he's a friend of mine as well. But this is the first year back since the pandemic of the full scale production. So it was super fun to be a part of that and to see the excitement around people coming back to the theater. We were sold out like pretty much.
It was hard to
get
tickets.
Yeah, yeah, it was.
Like, that's why I went after Christmas. Yeah. It was like right away, I could only find single tickets for it.
Yeah.
It was buzzing. It was awesome. And it was different than the ones I've seen before. There was a lot went into it, it looked like, with the screens and things moving.
Yeah, I mean, Theatre Calgary has invested in some really cool technology. That screen in the back is like this massive LED screen that they can make use of in so many different ways, and I think they did a wonderful job during Christmas Carol. And then the show that they're about to put up, I think, is also doing a really wonderful job of utilizing that technology and like sort of embracing these new technologies that we can utilize in live theater and like really enhance the experience. And then yeah, the adaptation, I think, is really for Christmas Carol anyways, was really specific to Calgary, specific to Alberta, like calling folks into action and sort of like taking in the spirit of what that play is about.
Yeah.
And focusing it in on sort of the experience of living in Alberta, like as much as you can when you're adapting a Dickensian novella. But
And then Jekyll and Hyde, how was that for you? Because that looked like pretty intensive, and you were doing it every day for how many weeks?
8 shows a week for 3 weeks, and it was intense. Yeah, that was like a physical beast, that one, which is a line from the play. But yeah, for me, I like putting in having the opportunity to play a character like Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, which is like playing any of those sort of titular characters that are so storied is super intimidating, but also really fun, and trying to find like how can I do this differently than other folks have done it in the past. I was fortunate enough that adaptation was pretty new, and there was a lot of sort of new thoughts in it. The playwright is a fellow called Nick Lane out of the UK. He flew down actually to see opening, and we got to have some good chats about it. But yeah, I mean, I physically and vocally pushed myself to the edge on that one, which was a lot of fun to do as an actor. But I don't think I could have done that show any longer than I did. If it was a longer run, I would have had to make different choices.
I forgot I was even at a live play. Like, it felt like a movie to me. I was so into it. It was intense. Yeah. And so I was thinking, do you take any of that with you? Like, when you're not on stage anymore during the days, are you like feeling that character still?
I think in certain ways, yeah. I mean, I don't do it like, I'm not someone who goes into like the method acting where I'll like lock myself in
like
in my apartment.
Ledger. Yeah.
Like I don't, that's not my approach. That's not my way in, but I do sort of subtly have that going around with me. I'm reading the play often. Mm-hmm. Reading it in different states of mind, and you spend 8 hours a day, 6 days a week in that character.
Yeah,
so it does bleed. It's hard not to sort of carry it around with you. And then especially when you're working on like the biggest thing is actually just like carrying the dialect around with me. So I'm like working in these different dialects, and I find myself leaving the rehearsal hall and I was speaking that dialect because it was 2 shows in a row that I was using that sort of that it's called RP, like received pronunciation, was one, like if the character of Dr. Jekyll, I was using sort of received pronunciation, which is a dialect of a British dialect. And then for Hyde, I was using more of like a Cockney kind of accent.
Yeah.
But I was in that accent for like 4 months.
Yeah.
So when I was not in the rehearsal hall, I was just like
ordering a coffee.
coffee with the accent. So that's kind of how it carries with me. But I guess the themes and the darkness of it can sort of seep into daily life, but I've kind of come up with strategies of like leaving that in the room. The cast on Jekyll and Hyde, like Ali Lynch, Daniel Fong, Grant Tilley, the director, Javier Villalta, we had like good sort of check-ins and outs where we can kind of leave that emotion in the room and then go on with your day, because if you don't, it's not a sustainable career.
Yeah. I saw you run a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Is that helpful when you're working so intensively like that?
Yeah, I definitely process the emotions of the play. I learn my lines when I'm running. So like I go for a run every morning, and I'll run the lines in my head as I'm going, or if I'm going on an easier sort of run, I'll actually just be speaking them out loud. So that kind of, I'm sure, is alarming to other folks on the path, but I will process the play as I'm running. And then also, even if I'm not working on a project, I find like that physical activity and the act of running and the act of like endurance training has become essential to my life. Like it become essential to my like mental well-being, my physical well-being. So I'm always kind of training for a race or some sort of an endurance feat, because I need
what
that as
kind
much
of are you, so you're training for like a marathon or several?
I did three marathons in a year last year. So I did my first three marathons from my birthday was in November. So from November to November, I did three marathons. And then I'm training for another one in June. And then I'll be training for an ultra marathon in July. And the ultra marathon's a 50 miler.
Wow. I ran out of breath putting my boots on today. So, but that's amazing. Have you ever done the Canmore one? Or there's one in Canmore.
Like an ultra marathon? Or?
It's a marathon.
I haven't done the Canmore marathon yet, no. I did Calgary, Edmonton, and then one called in Boundary Bay and in sort of southern Vancouver, or just south of Vancouver.
I was thinking about doing the Canmore one, but it takes a lot of work.
You should do it, man. I mean, it just takes consistent work.
Cardio would be good. Yeah. It's really healthy for your mind and your body, as you know.
Well, and I find the metaphor, like the idea of endurance training or like running a marathon is so applicable to any other artistic practice, physical practice. It's not like you're going to go out today and run 42 kilometers.
Yeah.
You'll run a little bit every day for your life. And then running a marathon kind of is easy. And that sort of like approach is what I take to my artistic practice. It's not about creating something huge and amazing every single day. It's about doing little bits of creative work every single day so that you're like building that base and building that habit and building that like that system inside of you, so that over time and over consistency you have a practice and you have things to draw upon.
That's really good advice that could be applicable to anyone, so I like to hear it.
Which one of these did you put your wife in?
Cherry wood. It's the best.
Mom didn't want to be buried. I always remember her saying that.
She didn't like the bugs.
Cremation is also a lovely option.
$11,000 for this?
It's cherry.
You know, I could build one of them and bury them out back the house for next to nothing.
Well, that would be illegal, Mr. Bingley.
This is robbery, sir.
Sorry you feel that way. This is my livelihood. No different than you growing your stuff.
I disagree. You gotta die. There's no choice there.
I run a respectable family business, much like your parents did, Mr. Bingley. None of us dipped our toes in the black market.
We'll burn them. Fire them up.
All right. The cremation fee is $2,400 per body.
You got a two-for-one on that?
No.
Well, you've done theater, film, TV. There's a couple questions I had involving that. Like, what's the hardest? What's your favorite? And what do you think you're the most suited for?
Oh, those are great questions.
I didn't know what order to ask them in. So here's everything.
Yeah, I love that. So from film, theater, and TV, the core of it for me is always the same. It's just telling a truthful story, and it's just being able to share that with an audience. That's the core of it. But it is very different from medium to medium. So I'd say the most satisfying as an actor oftentimes is theater, because theater exists in this world that's a little bit outside of reality. So like if you see Jekyll and Hyde, I didn't have to be in the realm of reality for parts of that play. I could go completely completely emblematic. I didn't have to have a physical body that reflected a physical body that you would see walking around. I could be doing these massive gestures, working in this really exploded, like zoomed out kind of way. And that's really cathartic as an actor. I think a lot of actors like to go to those those big places. Film and TV, I find that's the most honest expression, or film, especially like if I'm doing an independent film with really character-driven narratives, with directors who are really interested in telling like slice of life, honest stories. I find that's where I can get the closest to that like reflection of reality that we try to embody as actors and as creators. And that can be really difficult because it's really exposed. Like we have a camera really tight into your face and you're telling the story like through a breath and through a look in your eyes. That's really vulnerable. That's really intimate and it's really exposed. So that can kind of like call on different sort of systems in the body that are closer to the core of who I am as Joe. And that's where that sort of like, I think that's why a lot of more film and TV actors go to that sort of, I don't like using the method acting as an example, because I don't think it's useful, but like when that sort of like physical confusion between the character and the actor can happen,
yeah,
is because it can be so intimate. And I find that difficult at times to tap into and then also to release afterwards. TV, I mean, this isn't the experience of everyone on TV, but like my main experience on television series have been sort of like post-apocalyptic stuff. So I was in Black Summer and The Expanse, both sort of, well, Expanse is kind of like a sci-fi series. Black Summer is a post-apocalyptic sort of zombie series. And I love working in that genre. Like genre stuff, I find first of all, it's super fun to do. You get to play with a lot of different stuff. You're playing with gore. You're playing with like a lot of prosthesis. You're doing green screen stuff.
Are you a fan of that that kind of thing when you watch also?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. So I find genre stuff now more than ever. Genre stuff can be like a more interesting, like, exploration of like what we're kind of going through as a society.
Yeah,
because it does sort of seem dystopian at times. And then so I find a lot of like filmmakers and I'm sure everybody sees the trend of these sort of like either multiverse or genre films that are really exploring what's going on around us right now.
Yeah, what could be. And people need a little bit of an escape, so mm-hmm. it's like an exaggerated version of things. It's really fun.
Yeah.
I watch that kind too. Which one did you say you're most suited for, do you think?
I don't think I can answer that question.
That's
just
fine.
Because I don't have an answer. I think like I love to do them all. I don't prefer one or the other. I think for me to be for me to feel like healthy and fulfilled as an actor, I need to be able to be dipping my toes in all of those mediums, whether it's like theater, film, genre, indie, like
it probably helps you stay sharp too if you cycle through them.
Yeah. I mean, you've seen me in a few different things. What do you think I'm most suited for?
Yeah, I guess you're right. I can't answer that either. It was great, all of them. Do you ever do musicals or comedy?
Yeah, I don't do musical. I haven't done musicals in the sense of like a full-on musical, if you're thinking of like...
I was thinking like Little Shop of Horrors kind of thing.
I would love to do a musical. My voice, I think, is more suited to sort of like folk kind of singing and stuff like that. There's in Little Shop of Horrors specifically, actually, I've always wanted to play the dentist.
Yeah.
A friend of mine just did Little Shop at Arts Club, or yeah, Arts Club and the Citadel. So Arts Club's in Vancouver and the Citadel's in Edmonton. And I love that. That musical actually was a formative reason as to why I'm an actor.
That's my favorite one.
It's so good.
Yeah, it is so good. Yeah, I just asked that because I've never, I you know, all the stuff I've seen, I haven't seen really those two things. Comedy?
Comedy, I've done, I guess, I'm understudying a comedy right now. So, like, at Theatre Calgary, they're doing Meteor Shower, which is a play written by Steve Martin. Mm-hmm. And it's a real absurd comedy. And it's been super fun. Like I said, I'm understudying, so I'm not up on my feet all that much with it. But watching, it's a four-hander, so two male, two female actors. It's sort of an exploration of marriage and coupling. But watching them put that together and watching the director like sort of create this comedic performance has been super fun. But for me, yeah, like, have I done many comedies? Some Shakespearean comedies. And definitely plays that are funny or poignant, but mm-hmm. not like full-on comedies.
What happens? So you're an understudy right now.
Mm-hmm.
What happens? What do you do as an understudy, and what? How does it work?
It's kind of different depending on the theater company, depending on the contract. So in this production. Like I said, it's a four-hander. There's two male presenting roles and two female presenting roles. So they have a male and a female understudy. And we both learn the two parts. So I'm learning the two male tracks. And essentially the way this process has worked is they've included us right from the beginning. So we're in the rehearsal hall right from the beginning, kind of sitting at the table, watching them block through the play. We're working on our lines as we can outside of the hall, but also following along and kind of working that through. And this isn't always the case, but the director's been allowing us to get up on our feet every once in a while and work through the blocking. But essentially, you're just an observer, and you're prepping yourself to go on if anybody gets sick, gets hurt. And we have the opportunity to do at least one full run with all the technical elements, all of the costumes and stuff like that. But it's become more common, especially after the pandemic, because there was such sort of like guidelines put in place for what would happen if somebody got COVID. But then to extend beyond that, I think before the pandemic, there's in theater for sure, there's been this sort of like the, you always hear the expression, like the show must go on. And if you're in theater, you understand what it means to have buckets in the wings, which just means mm-hmm. like, if you're feeling sick, you're feeling terrible, you don't stay home, you put buckets in the wings and you're puking between scenes. Like,
I've never heard that expression, and I feel like I'm going to use it now for my podcast.
That's what the expectation was before, but that's totally shifted since the pandemic, which has been, I think, really great, because I've definitely been in productions where I've had buckets in the wings, and not because anybody's forced me to, but because I've kind of forced myself to, and I thought that was the expectation. But now, like, if you're sick, don't go to work.
Yeah, right. Yeah, so since the pandemic and everything, you were saying that it seemed like theater was dying out a little bit after, and there's this big resurgence happening, and you've been noticing it with your shows. Do you want to talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, it was pretty scary, I'd say, sort of this sort of last, the year coming out, I mean, the COVID's still happening, but the year coming out of like a lot of the restrictions,
yeah,
people were not going back to theaters. I think all the companies kind of had a difficult time, not just in locally in Alberta, but I think across Canada, across the world, like live theater was, I think there was a sense that the folks thought it was in jeopardy.
Mm-hmm.
But there's been this great resurgence over the last, like, I don't know, in my observation, this is not any sort of like, there's no stats that I have to back any of this up, but in my observation, in the last like 12 months, 16 months, like people have been coming back to the theaters. Like all of the shows that I've worked on have sold really well, had really good attendances, and that's been true of other shows that I've been looking into that I haven't been working on. I think folks, after being sort of isolated and cooped up for so long, are excited to get back to the theaters. I think theater companies have been really good about programming stuff that's, like you said, people need an escape, people need to laugh, people need to get back into that like sort of groove. So they've
It's interesting because I think movie theaters are like empty for the most part. The attendance is way down. So maybe it's also you have a movie theater with Netflix and Prime mm-hmm. and everything just in your house.
Yeah.
But the live theater is more of an experience to go to.
Yeah.
So that might be part of it too.
I think that's huge. I think that's yeah. a great point.
I've been telling people to get out there and go to theater because I've always gone, but some people have never gone, never thought about going.
Well, you're a subscriber, right? Like you subscribe to Vertigo, you said?
Yeah.
What made you get that subscription? How long have you had it?
Over 10 years. My grandparents had it first and yeah. then my aunt added on. And then I got with my fiance two more tickets, and my mom also did. We're just
so it's like all, a family cause affair.
We used to, yeah, because someone would not be able to make it, and one of us would go, and then just add another season ticket for next year. We all want to go.
That's awesome.
And we're right in the kind of front two rows. It's exciting.
That's a great seat in that theater.
Yeah, some theaters. It's too close, mm-hmm. but that theater's kind of intimate and sort of, I think every seat is a good seat. Mm-hmm. But I have sat farther up. It's fun to be really up close. Like people are spitting on you.
Yeah. So do you take in other theater in Calgary, or is Vertigo kind of like your go-to, or do you take in other companies?
Yeah, I go to Stage West sometimes. Eat and watch. Mm-hmm. I went to a boy band musical there recently.
Yeah.
And then I want to go to Theater Calgary a lot more. It was expensive for a while. But it was so fun. The Christmas Carol was so fun and the lineup looks really good.
Yeah, the programming has been awesome and they've actually like and I'm this is me saying this from me. I have been working there the last 4 months, but this is me saying for me, but I think the programming is awesome. They put in that initiative where all of their orchestra tickets are $39, which is one of the more affordable tickets
yeah,
in Calgary for the, I mean, the highest production value theater in Calgary. But there's also so many other opportunities, and this is what I love, like kind of the opportunity to chat about the Calgary theater scene
yeah
in a different sort of space, is because there is so much going on that folks don't know. Like we've got making treaty seven working out of the Grand, and they've got a lot of great shows that I've seen there this year, and they've got a lot more coming up. The High Performance Rodeo is on right now. By the time this airs, it might be over. I don't know how long till this airs, but like
when does it go for?
The rodeo kicks off today with the So the High Performance Rodeo is something that the One Yellow Rabbit Theatre Company has done for a very long time, and it's brings in work from all across Canada that's at different stages of development and then presents it. And it's an amazing world-class festival that we have that so few people know about. But it kicks off tonight with the 10-minute play festival, where a bunch of companies have written a play over the last 24 hours. And it's unfortunate because folks won't
for how long?
Like 2 weeks, I believe. It'll go for like the next 2 weeks.
Yeah, it might be still going. Yeah, I've heard of that one. I haven't been.
Yeah, it's great. And then like all the other indie companies. So there's the companies that most folks would have heard of, which is like Alberta Theater Projects, Theater Calgary, and Vertigo. And then there's more independent companies. You've got Major Matt Mason. You've got Downstage, Verb, Chromatic, Ocho Rojo. All of these folks in the Calgary theater scene that work out of places like Motel, which is in Arts Commons, or the Grand, or just ad hoc places across the city. And this is a little bit, I just like to say those companies' names out loud because then folks know that they yeah. exist and
can. No, that's good. Them. That's what we're here for. And then you were saying there's a, when you're in film, there's a studio you work with a lot too.
There's a few, but like if like Alberta Stories or like one I'm wearing, this is a North Country Cinema. They kind of have they shoot out of like Alberta a lot. They're both I'm butchering this right now, but They've got some writer, producer, directors who live in Alberta, some who live in Toronto. But I work with them often. I think that they're great. They tell a lot of like really good Alberta stories. There's another local company, production company called Polyscope Productions that put on a lot of, they get a lot of work for local actors, local editors, and local crew. And I've worked with them since I was coming up. And so there's a lot going on film-wise.
Have you noticed a lot of new companies popping up, or a lot of people now, instead of traveling, moving to Vancouver, Toronto, actually moving to Calgary for some of these?
I'm not sure about the companies, but from an actor's perspective, I think there's a lot more actors coming from Toronto, Vancouver to work in Alberta. We still have some catching up to do, but we've just had, like, I'm sure you've heard, all those big productions coming through and really sort of showing the world at large, kind of like what Calgary has to offer as a location, and also not just as a location, but the caliber of our crew, the caliber of our actors, yeah. Has really sort of had, like, those productions will come here for the landscape, but they keep coming back because of our crew, because of all that, like what they're able to access here.
Yeah.
And that's more than just landscapes. It's talent. It's crew. It's everything.
I think Alberta is really making a push to expand that way. Sometimes the weather's probably a problem. That's the only thing I can think of, but, for a couple months anyway.
Yeah, exactly.
What do you think, this is unrelated, but we were talking about the writer strikes, mm-hmm. and dealing with AI in general coming into the artistic world.
Yeah. I mean, as far as the strike and the focus on AI, I think that was definitely something that needed to happen. Again, like I was highlight that was the American unions, mm-hmm. dealing with that, but that definitely sets a precedent for our unions here. Like I'm a member of both the film and the theater actors union, so ACTRA and Canadian Actors Equity are the two unions in Canada, and I'm a member of both of those. And the precedents that are set, in these agreements in the States and those American unions will definitely affect our bargaining. Which I think is necessary because, yeah, and with the AI question.
Also, because you also mentioned you wanted to get into writing.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of AI in writing now, too.
Well, folks using it to generate, yeah. And now, like, some submissions that I've been looking for, whether it's, like, for poetry or any other sort of writing, they get you to declare whether you've used AI to generate any material or not. Oh, wow. Which I think is great. It should be, if it is being used, it should be absolutely transparent. The scary thing as an actor is that it's our likeness. Like, and I think it could bleed into theater as much as it does film. Like film, you can create a face, you can create voices and then use it in perpetuity. And that's what the strike was about, was to kind of stop that sort of usurious nature of like, getting a likeness and then just like
it's free. Sure, yeah,
it's a free and I can do whatever I want with it, which is not the case. But even in theater, there's, because there's more multimedia, there's more multidisciplinary stuff going on. Like if you think of that wall at Theater Calgary, the LED walls, you can project whatever you want on there, right?
Yeah.
Or it's not projecting.
John Travolta could have been in that play.
Yeah,
for
exactly.
Free. Yeah.
So like they'll record our voices, they'll record video capture of us, and our unions have protections in place that they can only use those for the duration of that theatrical production. And I think we're just going to have to be more and more diligent about keeping up with what those technologies can do. Cause for me, it's never about like stopping a technology from happening or stopping.
Yeah.
But it is about like thinking critically, regulating and being realistic about like what are responsible uses of these technologies and what are uses that are detrimental to folks.
I never thought of it coming into live theater at all. I thought you were just at least safe there, but
no.
Yeah, that's interesting. I guess with the writing too, it's it might just become part of it. Maybe someone inputs really well to help like assist them with the writing. AI is not really as creative though.
Well, and it's also, where is it drawing from? Like, these are all things I'm not an expert on AI in any way, shape or form, but like, where is it drawing from? It's not having these thoughts. It's drawing from folks who have written things and put things on the internet. So it's essentially taking these things that already exist. It's not having an original thought. It's cobbling together other folks' ideas that have been put on the internet. So how do you source that? How do you say, like, I created this thing, I use the help of AI, but then where did AI source that from? It could be taking it from another writer. It could be, it most certainly is taking it from another writer, because it's not having an original thought. It's taking what it sourced from the internet that was put on there by another person's mind.
Yeah, that's true. What are your sort of aspirations on the writing side of things?
I'm still kind of figuring that out. After like working on so many independent films and getting sort of this creative push through endurance training and through getting back into acting full time over the last few years, I've got different avenues of writing, whether it's poetry, screenplay writing. I don't really have aspirations for it right now. Right now, I just really am enjoying doing it. My goals, kind of over the last little bit, has been to always be creating, endurance training, acting, and just sort of making stuff. So in that light, if I feel like writing poems, I'm writing poems. If
what
I feel
about,
like working on a play, I work on a play.
Directing. Are you interested in that at all?
I have directed theater. I direct theater. I've done that before, and that's something that's an outlet that I do like to use every once in a while. Directing film, I feel like I would have to have a partnership with somebody who has the technical knowledge. I've never directed a film. I've only acted in films. But I would love to be honest. But I would need somebody who is either a cinematographer or like a co-director who knew the technical side of things a little bit more, because I think I understand character and story and performance, and I understand shots to a certain degree, but when it gets to lenses and lighting and all that sort of stuff, I kind of get out of my depth.
So how big of a team is it? Like in theater and TV and movies, what's the difference between how big that side of it is?
I would say it's not about the medium. It's about the size of the production. So in theater, you could have a team of six, and that could be your whole team. You could have a couple of actors, you could have a director, you could have a writer, you could have a stage manager, and you could have a designer, and it could be that small. Or if you're working at Theatre Calgary, it's tens of people, tens to sometimes upwards of 100 people on a production. So if you look at Christmas Carol, for example, you have every aspect of that is designed. So you have the music design and sound design is composed. You have the sets and costumes, those are composed, but then they're executed. Like, there's the designers and then there's the folks who are building the costumes. So the teams can get huge.
I was wondering actually about that, the musical number there in the Christmas Carol.
Yeah.
Do they run through it with other people when they're designing it? Do they use other people and then do it with the actors?
Oh, that's a great question. No, I don't. They use us for that. So like, you're talking about the big Fezziwig number?
Yeah.
So the music for that is composed and played by Allison Lynch, who is the fiddler in that show.
Yeah.
So she designed and composed and performs it. And then Jesse Robb, who is a choreographer who is out of New York, came in and he choreographed that with us.
Oh.
So when we get hired for that show, we're not really hired as dancers. We're hired as kind of as actors first.
Yeah.
Who, like I didn't sing or dance at all in the audition. So they just sort of, Jesse came in and sort of takes stock of the room. And he's like, okay, so what kind of skills do we have here? And actually, this is a good, like he comes in on the first day and he's like, okay, I'm going to teach you all like a section of steps. You do a section of steps. People do it to varying degrees of success or failure. And it's fun and funny. But he's unknowingly, he's kind of teaching us the choreography as it goes. He's going to use this stuff later. And then he's like, puts a couple of benches in the middle of the room, and he's like, who can jump over these benches in an interesting way?
Yeah, there was a lot going on in that.
But yeah, they choreographed that with us, and that, like, Theater Calgary brings in, like, world-class folks to work on that. Like, Jesse is working on stuff on Broadway right now, and was flying in to work with us. Like, it was a great experience. I mean, it's fun to be a non-dancer, non-singer, and then be in a big musical number and be like, oh, I just sang and danced.
Like, there was how many people? Like 30 people in that? All. There was a lot going on.
It feels like 30, but I think it was 13.
Oh, really?
Yeah. It feels like 30, though. Like, yeah, but the whole cast, I think, is 13 or 14.
Yeah, I just, for some reason, I thought they would design it with sort of stand-ins and then teach you.
You'd have to ask Jesse, who the choreographer, how he does it in his mind, but no, that's all choreographed and worked through with us during the rehearsal process. We spent a lot of time on that number. As you can see, it's a fairly complex number.
Everyone standing ovation after that, just you don't see a lot in the middle of a play, so that was fun.
Oh, nice.
I'm like timid and shy and nervous, and so I wouldn't be able to go on stage like you. I would probably just faint. Like, when I was little, I had to say a prayer into the microphone in, like, third grade. Yeah. I think I just fainted.
Really?
I do not like that at all. So at least here, we just have a couple people, lights. It's a little bit easier. But, yeah, I'm nervous. So it's a learning curve for me.
So how do you approach those nerves? Like, I think that's such a common thing in any job, but in these sorts of jobs where, you know, folks are watching, like, how do you approach that?
I forget that there's people watching.
Sorry to remind you. I'm sorry.
Yeah. Now that you're saying that, a little bit of practice helps.
Yeah.
It was very bad at the start. but that actually reminds me of a question I was going to ask you about nerves, mm-hmm. and things like that. So you're not, how nervous do you get for live theater, first of all?
Yeah.
You seem comfortable.
I've learned skills to become comfortable, but there are times that I get nervous. There are times still that I get nervous, but it's different now. Like, I can remember back to Mount Royal, like probably right around when we would have met for the first time. I was doing a play called Brighton Beach Memoirs. As part of that program, and the play started off with like a fairly decent monologue that I had to say, and I got so nervous, and I was like, early in my career, I'd only done some stuff in high school theater, and then like a few productions on sort of smaller stages or black boxes. I remember getting so nervous going out for that first monologue, I couldn't like hold a piece of paper. I had a prop that I couldn't hold, and my hands were shaking. I couldn't even hold it, and then I blanked on my lines completely. And I sat there for what felt like an eternity, but I think it was maybe 30 seconds or something, 30 seconds or more. And then the lines came back to me. I started saying the monologue, but that sort of my nervous system had kicked into high gear. So like my mouth filled with spit, and I was in the middle of the monologue, and I'm just drooling down my chin. So that experience taught me the only way that I personally can deal with nerves is to be prepared for anything. So like when I'm going into theater, like if I'm thinking for Jekyll and Hyde, like I was prepared for any eventuality. I did a play at ATP, what would have been like 7 years ago, maybe more, called The Circle. It was also written by Jeffrey Brown, who did the adaptation of Christmas Carol. But that play was a bunch of like chaotic teenagers on stage for the entire play. And there was like bongs that were meant to break at certain times. There's like bits where there's like a fight with a lightsaber, there's a sword on stage, there's all this chaos going on. And in my mind, I was so nervous that something would go wrong at the wrong time that I started planning like contingency plans for mm-hmm. anything that might go wrong. So I'm like, oh shit, if the bong breaks early, then I'll do this, this, and this. If this happens here, I'll go this, this, and this. So it's more than just being prepared for my lines. It's being prepared for sort of any eventuality, but then also being comfortable with like improv, like not improv in the sense of like improv comedy, but like if something goes awry, I'm not going to be like, oh, stop the show. Okay, we're going to take that back.
I was actually, deal with it. I was thinking of trying to take an improv course to help with this. And
it's a great idea.
Yeah, just to create the skills that I don't have. I'm so nervous about that too, though. But I think improv would be really helpful.
Well, even just that, yeah, that connection between like how do you take what's going on and not try to change it, but try to use it in the best form possible.
Yeah.
So if you're like on stage and I don't know, something breaks or somebody forgets a line, instead of trying to pretend like it's not happening, how do you use what's happening?
I'm nervous to go on stage, really.
Yeah.
Yeah. But, and then I was going to ask, how is it different? Let's say you're on like a first date or something. How are your nerves different in something like that compared to going on stage? Are you able to handle it in the same way?
No. I don't know about the first date question, or but whatever. Like about like social interactions. I think like so many other people, I'm not unique or special in this. I just like, I'm like, oh man, I don't feel like I'm doing a good job right now. Like right now this feels like a comfortable conversation, but like if I'm,
yeah,
I'll go and open a play and the opening night, the adrenaline from the performance will feel great. And then I'll be more nervous to go out into the party afterwards, yeah, and chat with folks, just because that's where all of those insecurities kick in. Like at least on a stage or on a film set, I've got lines, I've got blocking, I've got a character that I've
crafted.
And it's
like one way,
yeah,
relationship.
Exactly.
I thought you just sort of trained yourself to have ultra confidence for the rest of your life.
No, maybe the facade of ultra confidence,
yeah.
But no, those social interactions. I mean, I find if I have to do a scripted play, I'm feeling way less nervous than if I have to like give a speech or an interview or something like that. Those make me more nervous because it's more exposed. Like, and that's why I could see with the podcast, like you're not being a character, you're being yourself, and that's vulnerable, right? And that's to me more nerve-wracking to be vulnerable as me than it is to be vulnerable as a character.
Yeah, I get stressed out. Like I was up late.
You're killing it. This has been very comfortable for me. So the stress that you're feeling has made,
thanks,
is paying off in the comfort of the guests.
That's good. It took some work and I'm getting better and I'm sure I'll get better.
Mm-hmm.
And that, I forgot what I was going to say because of that. I had something next. I was going to let you talk about any projects you have coming up or any companies you wanted to talk about.
Yeah, for sure. Well, there's the show that's going on at Theatre Calgary. So if you're, I don't know when this will air.
What is that, by the way?
So Meteor Shower, written by Steve Martin. Some great actors in there. It's going up from January 26th till February 11th, I believe, are the dates. And again, it has those $39 tickets. It's hilarious. I'm understudying that. So if you go and see that, you probably won't see me. You'll see the main company. Hopefully, like that's the goal always is,
You said you were doing one or
I'll do one, but, it's not a public performance.
Oh, okay.
So it's like, it's for me to know the elements and do that. And honestly, when I take this gig, it's like, I want to be there to support the main company. I would love, it's a fun play. It's hilarious, but that ensemble of four has done such a great job crafting these performances that it would be a shame for an audience not to see that. I would feel confident in my performance. I feel like I'd be able to support it and folks would enjoy themselves, but those four are crushing it, doing such a good job. So that goes till January 11th. And then the next show that I'll be doing will be in Rosebud. And it's funny about the running and like endurance training and performing because it's going to be Chariots of Fire. I don't know if you're familiar with the story. So it's the stage adaptation of Chariots of Fire.
That's awesome. That's perfect for you.
Yeah. I'm pumped to like live in Rosebud. I'll be playing Eric Liddell, which is one of the lead guys. So it's Eric Liddell and Harold Abrams are the two lead sort of protagonists of that story. So that'll be in March. It'll be going up in April. And I'm sure you can put the dates in or whatever.
But sure, yeah.
I'm really excited about that play. I've done it once before as an ensemble character. I did it in the Grand Theatre in London, Ontario, as an ensemble member. But being able to come and do it now as the Eric Liddell character, I'm super excited about that one. I think it's going to be a lot of fun.
Yeah, that should be awesome. Where did you say that one was? At
It's in Rosebud. It's at the Rosebud Opera House. So it's Rosebud Theatre. And it's a long run. It's from March, April, like early April till May 25th.
Every day?
I think they run, I don't have the schedule because we don't start till March. Yeah. But I think they run I don't want to get this wrong, but I think it's Wednesday to Saturday. Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. I think it's Wednesday to Saturday. Mm-hmm. For that length of time. So it's nice. They kind of have it's a rural community. But it's like really well attended. Folks go out there, I think, all the time for it. I'm really pumped to be a part of that show.
Take a drink too.
I'm just constantly sipping and drinking coffee as a.
Me too. I should get something without a cap, I think. I'm just gonna throw the cap away. I don't know why I keep putting the cap on, and then I'm doing it behind the camera.
It keeps the bubbles fresh. But yeah, and then I think there's been a couple of projects. I always lose track of film projects because you shoot them and then like two years later they'll come out. But there was a couple that I shot over the last year that should be coming out, but I don't have any information on those. So
yeah, I didn't really think of that, the time gap of when you're done a project and when it comes out. And maybe do some of them like not come out at all?
Yes, that hasn't been the case for any that I've been a part of. They've always come to fruition in some way or another. Mm-hmm. There's always different routes that you can take. Like if you're creating a film, I think, and again, I don't really know this side as intimately as some other folks, but I do have a good idea of it. But like, I think first of all, the first route is like festivals. So you'll submit to all the different festivals, whether that's Cannes, South by, Calgary International, Toronto International, Calgary Underground. And these festivals, like, I'm sure folks know a bit more about those, but like the Calgary International Film Festival and the Calgary Underground Film Festival are awesome festivals. You can catch a lot of good stuff there. But yeah, folks will submit to festivals first, and then through the festivals, you're essentially trying to get a distributor. And then through that distributor, then you'll see what avenues you're releasing on, whether it's theatrical, whether it's like streamers, that sort of thing. So
what's the longest time since you've finished something to actually seeing it, for you anyway?
It's been like, some have been years for sure.
Yeah.
The longest process all through, and it wasn't from actually like shooting to when it was released, but I did a project called Range Roads with North Country Cinema, who I was talking about earlier. And that project was super cool because the director, Kyle Thomas, had met up with the lead actor, Alana, Hawley, and myself a few years before. Like the whole entire process of that project was like probably 4 years or so, because it started out with him like working with us to create the characters, develop the story. And then we shot a short that was used to like get funds to shoot the feature, and then. So that whole process took years, like many, many years. But the result was really, really cool. So that's kind of the longest form project that I've been a part of.
I was wondering, because I was thinking, if you see something years later, and wondering if you would see it and think you would do things differently now that you've, you know, trained more or something like that.
100%. I think any project, whether or not a day has passed or a year or 10 years has passed, I think as an actor, I wouldn't say I'm a perfectionist, but I'm always like curious about other choices and curious about other sorts of, like, it's mostly getting new worldviews. Like, I've experienced more as a person, which means I understand more of the human condition, which means I can sort of like represent things in a different way. I would understand things in a different way. So yeah, whether a day has passed since a performance or a decade, I could look at it and think of how I could approach it differently. But I kind of try to release that.
That's
because
good.
I would go crazy, I think, or I would feel constant anxiety about it.
Yeah. Yeah, I know. That's what I do when I was watching all these back. Like, why did I say that? And then I'll show someone and they'll say, oh, that's funny that you said that. Like, okay, I guess. Feels weird for me, but.
It's such a bizarre thing and something that I've learned from other actors. One thing that I really love, and this isn't just actors, this is from, I can't remember who said this to me first, but it's something I've heard a few times. I do my best not to, I can feel really shitty about a performance. I can feel especially with a play or something, because you're doing it night after night, and it's not always the same. That's the beauty of live theater, is that it always kind of changes. And so if I have somebody who's coming to watch the show, who's an audience member or a friend or a family member who comes out, and I come out and I say like, oh man, I really didn't feel good about that performance. I don't think I did a good job. And that sort of robs them of the joy of the performance, mm-hmm. where they're like, oh no, I thought that you did a really good job, but you thought it was bad. So
yeah.
I'm wrong. Mm-hmm. So you're kind of like robbing them of that experience. So whenever I go out, I try to just be as, what's the word, like agnostic or what about the performance as possible. So you're not robbing other folks of that enjoyment or putting your perspective, which is tainted.
Because I think if you say I did bad tonight, they will always say you did good, and then you don't even, it's not believable.
No, you're just fishing.
Yeah, you're just saying that. I forget who it was. I was watching interviews with actors in the last couple of days, but it was a comedic actor. They asked him how it is doing drama, and he said anyone can be a dramatic actor if you realize life's a comedy. Like, if you take it a little bit less seriously, it's a lot easier to go through, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I agree with that statement wholeheartedly.
It's hard sometimes, though.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, it's strange being in mediums that just, like, kind of are trying to represent how people feel, how people go about their lives, and any art form, whether it's acting, writing, playing music, creating content, you're trying to connect with folks about how they are interacting with the human experience.
Mm-hmm.
And that's such a bizarre thing to do, because everybody's,
and do it authentically.
Yeah. Like,
you're good at it. It's very believable.
Thank you. You too.
My grandma went to the Christmas Carol with me, and all of you did a bit after about the food bank. So she wanted to give $100 to the food bank and have me mention it on the podcast. Maybe
sweet.
Other people will do it too. Maybe I'll make a GoFundMe or something. I don't know, but
That's sweet.
It's nice that you can use the theater to help too in those ways.
Well, I think especially with that play, like
that
initiative of the Toonies for Turkeys and giving to the food bank every year. I mean, it shouldn't be something. It's something that can be done all year, and it's something that we just get reminded of at Christmas. And that's so sweet of your grandmother. And that's honestly, knowing that the sort of intention of that play is going beyond just like the Christmas season, or just going beyond a little bit of entertainment, is really, really, really sweet. So please say a genuine thank you to your grandmother.
Yeah. And thank you. And well, all of you for spreading that. Yeah, it's good. If you have an audience, you might as well use it well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, when you can, for sure.
Yeah. I think we're going to wrap it up here.
Nice.
Yeah. Did you have fun?
Yeah, it's been a blast. I've never done an interview long form. I've done a couple. The only other podcast I did was about canning beer.
Oh, you can your own beer?
I used to work for a company that canned beer. That was like a mobile canning company.
Yeah.
And I was working on the mobile canning line, and I went on to like sort of a technical podcast where I was a guest that just sort of talked about canning machines. And that's the only other podcast.
Well,
I've done,
and so. I guess when you're interviewed, it's always about the one specific piece of art, and you probably know what they're going to ask, and it's like lines almost.
It's less conversational for sure. It's fun to, like, I love talking about this stuff, like with friends. So it's like, yeah, this was great.
Yeah. You can come on again too.
I'd love to.
It's fun. Yeah.
And I've, other folks who would be super interesting to talk to who are within the community, and not just actors, but like designers and
that would be
musicians.
Cool.
Like there's so many folks of so many different varying talents and interests in Calgary. Like you'll never run out of top quality folks.
Get me in touch with them, and maybe I'll be better even by then, so it'll be great.
Well, this was a great experience, so thanks so much for having me on. I'm excited to hear all the episodes that come out.
Yeah, thanks. I just sort of take the headphones off and I'm just done with the interview.
I'm just done. It's over.